Hi, it's Katrina. From the crust peeling off to a fire-breathing mountain, here are 8 exciting events that are happening on Earth. Number 8, the crust is peeling. In 1969, over a dozen people were killed in Portugal by a tsunami that was caused by a giant earthquake off the coast. An even larger earthquake had hit the area around 200 years ago, destroying the city of Lisbon and killing over 100,000 people. Both earthquakes started in relatively flat ocean beds, away from any cracks or faults in the Earth's crust, which puzzled seismologists. How did this happen? There are various theories for what may have caused the tremors, of course. In April, a group of scientists at the European Geosciences Union General Assembly in Vienna reported that a tectonic plate may be peeling into 2 layers off the Portuguese coast. In other words, the top of a plate may be separating from the bottom, thus creating a new subduction zone. This phenomenon has never been observed. According to National Geographic, the peeling is probably being caused by a water-absorbing layer in the middle of the tectonic plate thanks to serpentinization, a geological process during which water seeps into the plate's cracks, causing soft green minerals to penetrate the layer and change the crystal structure. Theoretically, if enough weakness is caused by this process, it makes sense that the bottom layer would peel away from the top. Tiny fractures caused by this could trigger the development of a new subduction zone. This hypothesis was tested on 2-dimensional models, and the findings were plausible. However, the theory has yet to be proven or discussed in a peer-reviewed academic journal. If so, it would be one of the most exciting discoveries for seismologists and geologists in a while. Number 7. Deepest dive ever. In May of this year, the deepest dive in history was achieved by explorer and businessman Victor Vescovo. He descended 35,853 feet to the bottom of the Challenger Deep at the southern end of the Mariana Trench, and the deepest point on the planet. The people that have made it into the depths of the Mariana Trench are members of a very small club. The first person to successfully make it down the trench was oceanographer Don Walsh in 1960. He was accompanied by Swiss oceanographer and engineer Jacques Picard. The pair reached a depth of 10,916 meters. It wasn't until 2012 when Canadian film director James Cameron returned and went down in the submersible vessel Deep Sea Challenger, diving to a depth of 10,908 meters. As Vescovo descended alone in a submersible ship called the DSV Limiting Factor, Don Walsh accompanied a team up above on the ship. After 3.5 to 4 hours, Vescovo reached a flat beige silt-covered basin, the seemingly uneventful surroundings marking his achievement of a record-breaking depth. In an interview with Live Science, Walsh recounted his journey to the world's deepest point inside a submersible designed to withstand extreme pressures as so very peaceful, as well as chilly and quiet. At the depth Walsh reached, the pressure is 16,000 pounds per square inch, over 1,000 times that at sea level. Other team members took 4 subsequent dives into the trench after Vescovo's record-breaking descent. Throughout the 5 dives, the explorers observed all kinds of mysterious and new things, such as red and yellow rocky outcrops that can convert carbon-containing molecules into organic matter. Additionally, the divers observed various critters, including small translucent animals, arrowtooth seals at 9,843 feet, as well as Mariana snailfish and giant amphipods, or shell-less crustaceans, at 26,247 feet. The team also believes they discovered 4 new species of amphipods, including 2 at their deepest point. Sadly, even at these depths, Vescovo believes he also came across a plastic bag and candy wrappers. And now for number 6. But first, be sure to subscribe and let me know what topics you would like to see in the next videos. Leave your idea with hashtag OriginsExplained to make sure I see it. If your topic is chosen, I'll be sure to give you a shout out. Number 6. Blob of rock triggers earthquakes. Every year, over 100 earthquakes of a magnitude of 4.0 or greater strike throughout the Hindu Kush mountain range, which stretches some 500 miles along the border of Afghanistan and Pakistan. Scientists aren't sure why, but it's one of Earth's most seismically active regions, especially for intermediate-depth earthquakes, which form between 45 and 190 miles below the surface. The region sits far from the slow-motion crash zone where the Eurasian and Indian tectonic plates steadily collide, and it also doesn't sit above a major fault line. So why are there so many earthquakes? Turns out that a long blob of rock underneath the Hindu Kush Mountains may be slowly dripping into the Earth's mantle, owing to the so far unexplainable seismic activity. The 100-mile-deep blob may be pulling away from the Earth's crust at a rate of 4 inches annually, triggering the frequent earthquakes. Researchers discovered what they are calling the Blob after years of careful observation of earthquakes near the Hindu Kush Mountains, which revealed a round patch of seismic activity on the Earth's surface, as well as a clear vertical axis along which the quakes form. They also learned that earthquakes most commonly occurred deeper down, where the Earth's crust meets the upper mantle. All signs point toward the blob of rock, which likely began no more than 10 million years ago. It's moving 10 times faster than the colliding Eurasian and Indian tectonic plates that are moving the mountains above. That's kind of fast. Number 5. The Great Whirl. The Great Whirl was first recorded in 1866 by British geographer Alexander Findlay. It's a churning, clockwise ocean whirlpool the size of Colorado that appears off the coast of Somalia every spring. It's so big, it can be seen from space, and recent satellite images reveal that it's bigger and longer lasting than previously thought. According to Findlay, the churning clockwise vortex created a very heavy, confused sea. He cautions sailors to avoid its powerful currents when approaching the African coast. Monsoon winds are thought to play a part in the formation of the vortex, yet the vortex begins forming in April, about 2 months before the monsoon, and continues for about a month after the monsoon ends. The arrival of annual Rossby waves in the Indian Ocean signify the beginning of the whirlpool. These slow-moving waves are just inches high, but fuel the vortex with their reservoirs of stored energy. The vortex can expand to over 300 miles wide at its peak. Because of its large size, the vortex behaves differently than smaller whirlpools, and deeper research has proven to be challenging for scientists. A recent study has shown that pirates operating near the Somali coast have also interfered with research efforts. Scientists recently analyzed 23 years of satellite observations and ocean circulation models and concluded that the average lifespan of the whirlpool is roughly 198 days, much longer than the original long-believed estimate of 140 days. It also lasts through December and sometimes into January, at least a month longer than previously thought. At its most intense, the Great Whirl covered an average of 106,000 square miles. Lead study author Bryce Melzer, a satellite oceanographer at Stennis Space Center in Mississippi, believes that learning more about the Great Whirl can help scientists detect patterns that shape monsoon formation, which would help forecast how much rain the seasonal event will bring to India. Number 4. Methane Fire-Breathing Mountain. For more than 2,000 years, a mountain in Turkey has been steadily spewing fire. This strange formation is known as the Chimera Seep, or the Flames of Chimera. While it is true that the gods might be unhappy, as the legend goes, according to a recent New York Times article, the flames are being caused by a bizarre geological phenomenon that scientists can't quite explain. The bursts of fire are fueled by methane seeping out from underground. It's not the typical methane produced by decaying organic matter, however. Turkey's eternal flame is fueled by a gas called abiotic methane, which is produced by chemical reactions between rocks and deep underground water. Hundreds of abiotic methane deposits have been discovered on land and in seas throughout the world in the past decade by scientists who are part of the Deep Carbon Observatory, an international group studying the Earth's biosphere and its millions of undiscovered microbial species. Pretty cool, huh? While the phenomenon is not rare, it is mysterious, and scientists are trying to figure out how such methane is produced without any organic carbon. Number 3. Big ocean waves are getting bigger. Due to an increase in extreme winds, ocean waves throughout the world are getting bigger. Good for surfers, not so good for coastlines. This was recently determined in a study by a pair of scientists from the University of Melbourne, Australia, who monitored changes in the ocean using 33 years of satellite data. It's the biggest ever collection of wind and wave data yet. They measured the most extreme changes among the biggest waves and fastest winds. Over the same period, the top 10% of waves increased by a foot, while the top 10% of winds became faster by almost 5 feet per second. This means that the height of extreme waves increased by 5%, while extreme winds became 8% faster. The researchers confirmed their findings by comparing their satellite data with information from 80 buoys throughout the world's waterways. Ian Young, one of the study's authors, recently said in a statement that although increases of 5 and 8% might not seem like much, if sustained into the future, such changes to our climate will have major impacts. The waves mean an increased risk of flooding for coastal communities and faster erosion of coastlines. For low-lying regions, this means ending up underwater sooner than planned, as the changes accelerate the effects of our already rising seas. While the southern hemisphere suffers the strongest effects of these waves, their impact will be felt all over the world. Number 2. Pause in earthquakes for California. It's been over a century since California has experienced a ground-rupturing massive earthquake. The last time this happened was in 1918, and everyone has been expecting one any day now. David Jackson, professor emeritus at the University of California, Berkeley, expressed concern over the lack of seismic activity at a 2014 conference in Alaska, calling into question scientists' data on historical earthquakes. Recent research shows that this 100-year lull is likely caused by a geological change. The study was conducted by two experienced experts on historical earthquakes, Glenn Biasi, a geophysicist, and paleoseismologist Catherine Scherer. They analyzed 1,000 years of records from 12 sites along California's major fault system and compared the time gaps between time-rupturing earthquakes. Based on that information, they determined that there was a 0.3% chance of all five of California's major branches remaining quiet for an entire century. In other words, the ongoing silence is unprecedented. Biasi predicted that while an earthquake may not be imminent, one could reasonably expect for 6 ground-rupturing earthquakes to occur over the next century. California experienced 6 ground-rupturing earthquakes between 1800 and 1900, followed by 2 more between 1900 and 1918. So if you live in California, be prepared just in case. Number 1. Radioactive carbon found in ocean trenches. You might be surprised to hear that crustaceans living in the deepest parts of the ocean have been found to contain radioactive carbon. These elevated levels of radiocarbon were found in amphipods up to 7 miles beneath the surface in the deep trenches of the Pacific Ocean. Amphipods at these dark and high-pressure depths scavenge for decaying organic matter that sinks down from above. A new study shows that their bodies have become infused with radiocarbon by eating the remains of animals that were exposed to nuclear fallout from Cold War-era nuclear tests. More specifically, they tested positive for something known as isotope carbon-14, or bomb carbon. Bomb carbon was formed during the 1950s and 60s, when neutrons spewed into the atmosphere as the result of global superpowers detonating nuclear bombs. The carbon-14 was absorbed by marine life as it entered the ocean. While it's true that the atmosphere and some living things contain naturally occurring levels of carbon-14, atmospheric radiocarbon levels doubled by the 1960s, and since nuclear testing began. Elevated levels of carbon-14 appeared in marine mammals near the surface soon after the first nuclear explosions. Researchers went deeper for the new study, collecting amphipod samples from the Mariana, Massaw, and New Britain trenches, all located in the tropical western Pacific. The study shows how creatures at the ocean's lowest depths are affected by the impact of human activity on ocean ecosystems near the surface. Thanks for watching! Would you like to learn more about the changes our planet is experiencing? Let me know in the comments below, and remember to subscribe and leave your video topic idea with hashtag OriginsExplained. See you later! Bye!